Thank you. Looking forward to the workshop. It's going to be actually a very interesting experience. We have a top-notch scientist and also engineers from JPL and Caltech and all around the world. So looking forward to it. And special thanks to actually organizers, co-organizers, Julie and Karen, and also our former director of JPL, Charles Ilachi, is here. So thank you so much, Charles, for joining us. So this is our new spacecraft lab at Caltech. You're seeing the gentleman here who's actually standing here without fear, just below this asteroid model. It's actually a very unique setup, flat floor made of epoxy, and it's high precision flat floor so that it can simulate this kind of a frictionless motion. So what do we have? We have, we're only seeing two, but we have a six DOF spacecraft simulators. So it can move up and down. So you're viewing this upper stage as a kind of spacecraft. It's sitting on top of a spherical air bearing that can actually simulate the three DOF attitude motion, and it can move up and down, and then it can freely kind of translate, so it completes a six DOF motion. So we have an onboard computer, very powerful, and we have an inter-satellite communication. We can simulate all various guidance, navigation, control algorithms, and so on. So main application is essentially swarm formation flying and so on. And also we have multiple projects with the JPL looking at this autonomous navigation approaching a small body and so on. So that kind of technology will be very relevant. And so we are going to talk about some of the form of multi-spacecraft based navigation as well. But I'm going to start with the motivation for why we want to have multiple, maybe small set. So Christina gave an excellent overview of a CubeSat or small set. And I'm going to get that into a multiple systems. And some definitions, in particular, difference between constellations and maybe a formation flying. And then I'm going to probably focus on the actual guidance and control algorithms that can actually enable this swarm of formation flying concepts. And as I said, I'm going to talk about briefly navigation and the actual shape estimation using the onboard camera without prior information. So basically, as kind of generating this very detailed model of a comet. So with that, if you actually remember the title of my talk, Stronger Together, something like that. So why you need more than one spacecraft? Because spacecraft can be lonely, too. So this is onboard reconfiguration video using two spacecraft and four spacecraft. And then they are basically starting from random positions, figuring out the relative location of your neighboring spacecraft. And then using onboard computation, it actually fires thrusters. So it's a work by students who are here, Rebecca Faust, Serena Loop, and Yashuans, and other students. And then they are basically not just flying in formation. They are coming together and make a certain structure. So we have also autonomous docking mechanism that can be enabled based on the distance and relative orientation. And then we also have as actuators, electromagnets that can be actuated to bring this spacecraft together. You are seeing this. But otherwise, so that's the best part of my talk, so I didn't stop the music. So we have a spacecraft-like actuators. We have 16 thrusters that control the motions, translation motion, and so attitude control. And also we have a reaction wheel assembly. We are going to add four of them that can be controlling the orientation or attitude of a spacecraft. And then for computers, we can go into detail. This is a very popular embedded processor, TX2, NVIDIA. Some of the perception algorithms, we are using some GPU acceleration. That's Alex Harvard's work. So we are going to talk about it later throughout the week. So what kind of application we can think about? This is some of the video created by Yashwan Snaka, my PhD student. Some Earth observation, we can actually fly a formation flying spacecraft. And interestingly, we can also think about not just position control, but we can synchronize the pointing attitude. If you have a target, and then you can actually synchronize the actual orientation of spacecraft based on the location of them. I love this picture created by Julie. This is basically a representative picture for our workshop coming up. And you can see that we talk about mother spacecraft, so we can launch some spacecraft from the mother spacecraft heterogeneity, heterogeneous platform. We can actually have multiple spacecraft that can be launched, and then we can have multiple sensors and multiple different types of instruments. So these heterogeneous like a spacecraft can be deployed. So it kind of captures that complexity. And then some of the algorithms I'm going to discuss actually work for heterogeneous platforms as well, with a certain kind of caveats. And it can be also applied to like swarms of aerial robots, and that's actually another part of my research. So I just recently published a special issue in the Transactions on Robotics, and also we had a survey paper that illustrates all the state-of-the-art control perception and navigation algorithms. This is actually drawn from the prior review paper written by Saptashi and other students. And we kind of surveyed all the existing concept and flight missions of multiple small sets. And then we categorize by the funding resources and also basically science missions. So now I take this opportunity to really give you the clear distinction, in our opinion, between the formation flying or precision formation flying spacecraft and just constellations. Let's start with the constellation. I mean, we have a multiple constellation satellites in space. So one prime example is a GPS. So they look like a kind of following certain pattern, but essentially they are individually following their own orbit or trajectory. So there is no coordination between satellites. So key difference between constellation and formation flying is basically when you define the control law, certain control strategies, do they rely on the knowledge of your neighboring spacecraft, either obtained by communication or basically observing your neighbors using relative navigation. So if you do have that kind of some interaction between neighbors, that's essentially formation flying. This covers constellation. You can actually broaden this concept. So if you have some coordination, not constantly, but maybe every day, once every day, or very occasionally, even if you have that infrequently, you might actually call that as a formation flying. And obviously that drives the complexity of the system. And the we talk about swarms and teams and coordination, constellation. So maybe one clear definition is that swarm typically refers to a much larger scale number of agents. But I think the definition could be subject to the actually the changes. But essentially, swarm means that a lot more agents opposed to team. Why we are interested in multiple spacecraft? Obviously, they are more robust. And this is actually just a conceptual experimental video from my prior lab, Illinois. If there are some malfunctioning spacecraft, you can actually just replace them. And or if you don't replace them, malfunctioning spacecraft, you can just reconfigure your formation into the different shapes so they continue your mission. So reconfigurability, adaptability, scalability, and maybe hopefully it comes at a lower cost because you have a multiple redundant agents. So that's the benefit of basically swarm, right? And obviously I'm going to continue to discuss science kind of a performance, you can actually cover a much larger area, but not just coverage, but also you can actually maybe get a much higher resolution. So I'm going to take a very old example of sparse apertures, because that was my original PhD topic long time ago. And you know what's the biggest aperture in space, that's Hubble Space Telescope. That's going to change pretty soon, hopefully, by James Webb Space Telescope. I made this slide when I was a PhD student. So that's actually 2000 before I graduate. So it's pretty old. But then at the time, our prime examples of a formation flying spacecraft were Stellar Interferometer Mission and also Terrestrial Planet Finder. There are four spacecraft free-flying missions or a coronagraph. What's the challenge? Because, scientists are greedy, they want to have the bigger and bigger aperture so they can get a finer angular resolution. But obviously, the launch fairing size is currently limited by maximum maybe 3 meter size, right? So how can you actually buck the trend or change the trend? So you can have a deployable meter, right, like a James Webb Space Telescope, or you actually can launch multiple satellites, multiple apertures, and then maybe you can combine those beams, hopefully coherent fashion, and you construct a virtually large aperture. But the challenge is that it's not easy because you need a precision formation and wavefront sensing and control and all these hierarchically staged kind of sensors and actuators. So that's my prior work in math as a student at MIT, we beat the three aperture interferometer. And another thing is that as you increase the diameter of the aperture, the cost of fabricating monolithic aperture increases actually quite fast. So you wanted to change this trend. So the answer is that you break the big monolithic aperture into the multiple pieces, and then basically launch them sequentially or together, and then maybe bring them together in space. So that's where when I was a grad student at MIT, that was my master's thesis testbed. It's actually three aperture interferometer. It's kind of showing the coordination between three aperture, like a wavefront sensing coordination, and then control. So obviously, I was thinner when I was a grad student. But this is my PhD topic. I was working on formation flying. So this is my former advisor, Dave Miller's SPHERES satellite testbed. And these were basically tethered formation flying testbed. So one application we can think about for workshop, we can also think about the tethered formation flying as a way to rendezvous with the asteroid or comet so that maybe you can use a tether motor to bring this spacecraft closer to the body. Many, many different applications. In terms of a cost, I was looking at the swarm aperture arrays, and then this is actually driven by radio applications. This is actually Golay arrays. So if you have six apertures, nine apertures, and 12 apertures, this is the most compact, non-redundant array configuration. So I was actually exploring this concept. Once you have swarms of spacecraft or apertures, way more than 12, maybe you have thousands of them. Maybe how can you actually distribute these apertures so that you can actually have a much larger angular resolution by looking at this modulation transfer function? So this is my prior work. And based on this, some of the analysis, let me present a very crude model of launching a spacecraft. We talked a little bit about the cost. So this is purely driven by mass. Very inaccurate. Maybe when I was finishing this paper with Fred, it was maybe 4 years ago, I actually entered the James Webb Space Telescope cost. At the time, it actually matched pretty well, and also Hubble Space Telescope. It's not going to match it right now, but it's inversely proportional to number of apertures. So you have more apertures, it's going to actually reduce the cost. A challenge of the difficulty, if you have a more complex system, then you will have a more cost here, so ranging from -2 to 2. If it's actually difficult, a mission is a 2. And then if you have a longer wavelength, it's easier to combine the beam, because the rule of thumb is that you have to bring these beams as a fraction of wavelengths. So if you have maybe that's a tenth of wavelengths, so obviously you can see that optical interferometer or sparse aperture, either Fischer or Michelson interferometer, it will be a lot more difficult than a radio frequency-based interferometer. So bottom line is that what kind of initial curve you have, as you increase number of apertures, obviously compared to the monolithic aperture-based mission, there will be a break-even point. Yes, you have multiple apertures. You have to bring these beams together. You have to correct path length differences. So yes, it's quite difficult, and there's a cost, heavy cost associated with this multi-aperture coordination and control. However, as you increase the aperture, there will be a break-even point where this multi-aperture-based emission will be cheaper than monolithic aperture. So that's the kind of overall trend we wanted to take advantage of. So now let's talk about what kind of guidance and control and also maybe estimation, navigation techniques can be used to enable this kind of a precision formation flying or just formation flying. So if you launch a spacecraft around the Earth, if you don't do any control, basically you will see, quickly, it's forming a string of pearls, right? So if you see this as a desired formation, then that's okay, but typically you don't have that as desired formation. So technology gaps, you want to actually deal with this complexity, dimensionality associated with the multi-agent aspect, because you have a large number of spacecraft, right? So there is a kind of algorithmic challenges, technological challenges, communication and sensors and so on. So that's something we want to actually have. So what kind of desired formation you want to have? Typically for multiple apertures, flying information for sensing, if you are observing such an object on Earth, where that object could be a three-dimensional cloud shape. Or it could be maybe looking at certain constructing sparse apertures. You want to have a certain desired pattern like this. So in order to achieve something like that, instead of a string of pearls, you have to look at multiple technological subsystems, including guidance and control. You have to avoid a collision, and then you have to consider dynamics of your vehicles. And then you can also think about estimation, relative navigation, and so on. So some of these technologies are being addressed in at Caltech, in my research group, in particular collaboration with the JPL and so on. People have worked on formation flying that involve maybe 4 to 6 spacecraft. Fred Hadda at JPL, now chip technologist at JPL, and then I teamed up with him so that we wanted to push the envelope of this swarm. So if you actually can have the thousands of spacecraft, maybe hundreds of spacecraft, changing the shape and reconfiguring their shapes from any initial condition, and then continue their kind of mission, maybe then 4 to 6 or tens of spacecraft formation flying or constellation will be an easy problem. So we need to really push the envelope so that we can actually solve the difficult problem. So that's actually swarm formation flying. And then we talked about CubeSat and MicroSat and different types of small set. And we wanted to actually look at the even smaller version, because maybe it's not practical to launch like thousands of 12U CubeSat. So we actually looked at 100-gram class satellite. And we did a point design. So Harish Manwara in the JPL actually looked into the miniaturizing every component of a spacecraft. So end result, is it really possible to build a 100-gram class satellite? Yes. You pull out your smartphone. It already has a pretty powerful processor. You might actually need some onboard processing because you are reconfiguring the system and so on. You get rid of maybe screen, but you have already battery, and you have a GPS and IMU. So you can turn that into actual pretty good satellite. So in fact, our point design, actually do have point designs, and basically the difference is that what kind of thruster technology we use. So this particular design is based on miniaturized hydrogen gas system, and this is actually a JPL proprietary micro thrusters. So the main technology and cost and mass drivers for this 100-gram satellites for swarm applications are thruster technologies and communication between satellites. So once you have these multiple satellites, I mean, the one idea is that you coordinate them. So I mean, sorry about showing some equations, but basically you can minimize certain cost function over time for number of agents, and then that cost function actually can be extended to include certain observation cost function, estimation cost function. So now we are tying that into the science objectives. Conventionally, we are just doing minimizing the fuel, but the idea of this kind of optimal control and reconfiguration is essentially from any initial conditions. You launch the spacecraft, or the small satellites are just deployed from mother spacecraft. You should be able to kind of figure out their relative locations and then basically shape that into the desired formation shape and relative rotational shape. So we have all these algorithms derived actually for this kind of mission. It can handle the nonlinear dynamics of the orbital dynamics of the spacecraft relative to the small body or long period of object, for example. And you can actually, each dynamics could be a different because you have a heterogeneous platforms. You have to make sure that fuel cost, thruster force should be bounded, and you can actually have to avoid a collision. So we have a different search of algorithms that can actually solve this problem in real time. So this is the end result, and maybe I have to mention that one thing we can deploy is that if it's actually Earth-based observation, then we can actually construct these relative orbits. So this kind of a swarms of a spacecraft forming a formation, and then they are kind of rotating around the Earth together. So just think this as a kind of small body, and then we can also form some certain kind of relative orbit, and while we can find the certain kind of velocity in each position so that they don't fire any thrusters. So they don't use any fuel propellant to maintain this kind of orbit for like 500 orbits for very long period of time. So this can be actually used as kind of parking orbits. So also this kind of relative periodic passive orbits can be used as kind of initial or terminal conditions of your optimization or reconfiguration problem that I showed earlier. So one example is the reconfiguration. This kind of algorithm serving this optimal control problem using real dynamics and so on for a very large number of dynamics. And then we have to say that this kind of a circle here is kind of communication radius. So you are relying on certain communication, but communication only with the neighbors, if you actually have some communication range. Only those spacecraft within that communication range transmit and receive their information about their future trajectory, current location, and so on. And then you can also apply that to swarms of aerial robots. And this is actually our new experimental facility and Caltech, where we can actually fly a large number of vehicles. So it's forming the alphabet CAST, CAST, Center for Autonomous Systems and Technologies at Caltech. And this is two spacecraft doing reconfiguration motion. It's almost like a two spacecraft kind of a dancing. So they are not lonely. We have a certain kind of approximation to avoid the collision and so on. That's actually using sequential convex programming. Here, it's actually joint work with JPL R&TD with Amir Lamani and Satoshi Bandyopadhyay and John Peter, and then also Francesca. And we actually have also an algorithm that can control this multiple number of spacecraft maneuvering around the small body. Or if it's an asteroid kind of field, then you have multiple asteroids, and you can actually avoid a collision with your main asteroid or multiple asteroids, while they are also avoiding a collision with other spacecraft. And then they follow a certain desired orbit for maximizing scientific observation. So now, just quickly to mention that you have like maybe thousands of spacecraft. Controlling and computing individual trajectory, although we do our best to simplify the algorithm and use a decentralized and distributed algorithms and technologies, still it's not going to scale well when you have like maybe hundreds of spacecraft. I mean, who knows that maybe we might come up with a concept at the end of this workshop. Maybe we have maybe five small sets. Maybe we might be interested in like launching and deploying maybe thousands of smaller femtosat and distribute them over a small body. Who knows? If that's the case, you might not want to actually compute the individual trajectories and then have them follow those individual trajectories. It might not be computationally possible because each spacecraft might not have the computational power. And also, it basically takes a lot of time to compute. So this is actually a new way of controlling large number of spacecraft or large number of autonomous agents or vehicles. It's called the probabilistic swarm guidance. And the essence is that instead of making an analogy to fluid dynamics. So the previous approach, you individually compute the individual trajectories. So it's almost like a Lagrangian approach. Then in contrast, in probabilistic swarm guidance, you compute the density distribution of your agents in certain partitioned beans, or tessellated beans. So you kind of tessellate three-dimensional space. And then basically, you construct a Markov chain or Markov matrix that can give you the transition probability between each beans. So that's actually a lot more computationally efficient because, for example, here, instead of computing the individual trajectories, you actually may be concerned about the time-varying distribution over the agents using this Markov chain. So there are a lot of math proofs behind this to actually come up with this algorithm. But essentially, we have simulated that using a certain formation shape. And this is Tajimar using 1 million agents. So one example is that we have now a NASA Center Innovation Fund with my former student, who is JPL Saptashi. Can you actually deploy this kind of a large number of gliders as a small satellite using a new space of a back shell of these Mars landers? So it's kind of a conceptual mission. Then once you have that kind of mission, you pack this articulated wing, you pull the wing, and so essentially these are satellites, and then you actually launch them. And then I did some simulation a long time ago, and then you can actually cover much, much larger area than single robot can do, for example, Mars Curiosity rover. Because you are basically launching a large number of gliders from the this 10 kilometer and 2 kilometer height, and then basically you can cover a large number of areas if you can actually deploy certain sensors. So is it possible to actually build, for example, 100 gram class aerial vehicles? Obviously, for a small body or long period object, we don't have an atmosphere that can be used for these flying vehicles, but we can come up with a certain kind of actuation schemes, right? So yes, so it's indeed possible to build a very small autonomous, like a bat-like robot. So just sidetrack here. This is the most advanced robotic bat to date.
Wow. Cool.
So cool, looks like a bat. Julie, right?
Yeah.
Of course, it's a real bat, so I was joking. So this is actually a real video taken by my collaborator at the Brown University. Actually, they are top-notch biologists studying the biomechanics of bat, also aerodynamics of bat. And so based on this kind of a collaboration, we really built most advanced robotic bat. It only weighs 100 grams, and it actually has a microprocessor and for onboard computation. And it has actually five joints with micro motors and encoder feedback, so it's not really simple servo motor. And we have a membrane wing. So to me, this is almost like a flapping kind of satellite, where this flapping is maybe flapping of the solar panel arrays for certain actuation, maybe. So next a few minutes, I'm going to just quickly go over some of the autonomy questions. So I think one big question for autonomy of guidance, navigation, control algorithms for multiple agents, I think the big contribution of autonomy will come from this perception. How can you actually look at this kind of a unknown object, for example, like this is a Oumuamua, and then we can actually create this kind of very detailed surface model, and maybe even the kind of actual solid model, so that we can actually use the gravity-based kind of a navigation and so on. And then I think there'll be a benefit of using multiple spacecraft. I'm going to briefly mention that. And throughout the workshop, we have an actual PhD student, and Alex will be joining us for the workshop. So they will hopefully present some of their algorithms in detail. So very briefly, as you approach the comet, this is actually 67P comet. And still don't remember the other name, because it doesn't sound as cute as Oumuamua. So, but this is a 67P that actual Rosetta spacecraft mission. So once you have a more sizable shape in your image, you can actually do some optical navigation. Very briefly, what kind of technique they have used? It's called the kind of stereo photoclinometry technique. It's very computationally intensive, and because you are using each pixel based kind of estimation, so in each pixel, there are three parameters you have to estimate. Basically, inclination that leads to a topographical shape of this one. So it's going to be XY inclination, and also the albedo. For each pixel, that's actually representing this whole shape. That's a lot of information. So, and also scientists on the ground actually identify the desirable features. So it's actually human-in-the-loop, basically, navigation system. Very computation intensive. So what you're trying to do is so JPL RNTD, ESA NASA and SHAM, we want to completely automate that process using feature-based kind of state-of-the-art computer vision and SLAM or structure from motion-based method. And so we have a certain algorithm that actually work using real Rosetta data. And then in furthermore, we have this SWARM autonomy project. So this is Alex Harvard work. We're actually doing all this hardware acceleration, GPU, and so on that can be shown that it can run in real time in some small microprocessor. The another thing that I want to mention is that once you have a multiple spacecraft, you know, GPS denied environment, because it's really far away from the Earth's orbit. You don't really have a way to kind of know the position of your spacecraft. So you are going to use this relative optical navigation, because the previous work that I just showed you is going to actually create the three-dimensional shape of this comet, and also the position and the orientation of this comet. That's the outcomes of the structure from motion, real-time incremental structure from motion algorithms. And also, you can know the relative position between the spacecraft and comet. At the same time, you have to understand where your neighbors are, the other spacecraft orbiting around their comet. And then for that purpose, because we don't have a GPS, we can actually do a relative navigation between the satellite, not between the comet and satellite. So we have a bunch of algorithms that actually use a computer vision-based method, and using some knowledge of dynamics that can be used to estimate the relative pose. Relative pose basically means the relative position and relative orientation. So in summary, we can actually build a lot more capable system using multiple agents. And each agent could be a small satellite. Do we have a video? So this is actually a favorite video from Disney Animation, Big Hero 6. And I have a, so this is a microbus. So you can see that they can kind of reconfigure into many, many different complex shapes.
By one person. That's just the beginning.
that's the basically philosophy of my research. You can create some more capable system in terms of scientific measurements and in terms of reducing the cost. But there is a cost associated with that. Basically, you have to deal with the complexity of a multi-agent system because you have a lot more system. But I think the best approach to solve this problem is to kind of coming together multiple background and so on. So one example is actually we have a Michael who's leading this swarm autonomy project with me. So we have a multi-year R&TD funded by JPL between CAST, Caltech, and JPL. So we have some, this is a Caltech team, it's JPL team in the previous year and the Caltech team. And so looking forward to working with you for this workshop. I learned a lot from actually interacting with multiple people with a very different backgrounds. So hopefully we will do that for the workshop. So thank you.